You know, he got it, and he now NOTW's mission has 1,000-some members, and there were only 5 men that in the beginning, and those 5 men all died. Was it worth it? It was them. It was hearing about them that spoke to my heart. And at 16, I sent in my application to NOTW's mission. I knew they were going to turn me down, but I was going to try. And lo and behold, they said, come ahead. So I turned 17 before I went out there. I dropped out of high school. I'm a high school dropout. And I went out there, and my boyfriend was a little bit furious with me, but he just felt I better tag along and look after this crazy girl. So he dropped out of college, and he came out with me, and we ended up getting married and have 6 kids, and we have 23 grandchildren, and get this, 31 great-grandchildren. So missionaries are busy people. You know, if you're willing to give your life, if you're willing to be a living sacrifice, to be expendable, that's a good thing. It's a good thing. There's no greater love has anyone than that he laid down his life for a friend.
The lady on the video there is Maxine Moreri, and she was a missionary to Bolivia, South America, to the IRA tribe for almost 60 years of her life. And she loves the Lord with her whole heart, soul, strength, and mind. And that woman, when she was here giving that message, that was a clip from when she was here. And when she came, that she just exudes the fruit of God's Spirit, which we're going to be talking about today in a little bit. But the love and the joy and the peace of God, you can even see it in the video of her, which is just amazing to me. And what we're doing with Missions Fest is trying to raise funds to help. The Bible that she held up, she actually translated. There was no Bible in the IRA language until she and her life work over there translated it into writing in their actual language. So she put the Bible in their native tongue. And we're wanting to raise funds to get all of those resources online to help her with this through the Missions Fest. And to also, one of the other things that our funds are going to go towards that we're raising through Missions Fest is in areas where they are illiterate and they do not read at all, the IRA tribe, helping purchase
what do they call them? They're audio New Testaments that run off of the sun. And so that we can get the Word of God into some of those other places where they couldn't even read it at this point. So anyway, please be a part. We need a lot of volunteers too to help us out with Missions Fest. So you could volunteer. There's a sign-up sheet out there. A lot of different kinds of things you could do to help volunteer. I want to encourage all of us to make it be a part of that day on Saturday, November 22nd. You could sign up on the to volunteer out at the Welcome Center or online on our website or our Facebook page. So I want to encourage you to do that. Also want to encourage you, if you have given your life to Christ, but you've never been baptized of your own choice as a choice to follow Christ, baptism is it's the greatest ceremony on planet Earth. There's none greater than it. It's actually 3 huge events all in one. It's your funeral, it's your birthday, and it's your wedding day with Christ. And really on that day is when you're saying, you know what, Jesus, I'm not living my life for myself anymore. And so this is your funeral. You're burying that old person under the water. You go under the water. I'm not that old person anymore. And then as you're raised up out of the water, as Christ was raised from the dead, you are being raised to a new life. What's new about your life? Now you're living for Christ. He leads your life instead of you. And then the Bible says in Romans 6 that we are united with Christ in our baptism. So in that sense, it's like a wedding day. It's where you formally commit publicly your commitment to Christ forever on this earth. And it's the greatest ceremony on planet earth. So if you've never committed to Christ in baptism, maybe you've given your heart to him and asked his spirit to come live in your heart. But if you've never been baptized of your own choice, I want to encourage you to make that commitment. And if you'd like to get, we're going to do baptisms next Sunday following the second worship hour at 12:30. And if you'd like to be baptized, be sure to write your name, phone number, and email address on your communication card, and then put check the box that says baptism, and I'll be in touch with you this week and give you the rest of the details. But do not pass up that opportunity. We'll do them following the second hour at about 12:30 next Sunday. Okay? So don't miss that. Now, with that said, today we are in a series I've called Season 3 of our Not of This World series. This is week 5, and today's message I've entitled A Tree and Its Fruit. What we've been doing is I've been preaching through Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. It's in Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7. A year ago, I preached chapter 5 last fall, and then this spring I preached chapter 6. And then this fall, we're preaching chapter 7. We're just going through verse by verse and seeing what Jesus teaches us about how to live in this world but not of this world, and why that's important and what that looks like. So that's what we've been doing. If you're new here today, that gets you kind of caught up. Our key verse for the series has been John chapter 17, verse 16 through 18. And we'll put it on the screen here. And I want to encourage you all, let's say it together big and loud. Or you could do it from your bulletins. Oh, there it is. Almost. John 17. We're about ready to find it. There it is. Yay. Okay. So if you would, let's say the verse reference and the whole verse together, all together, big and loud. Ready? Here we go. John 17, 16 through 18. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. Now, this is Jesus speaking, and what he's basically saying is, Father, as you sent me into this world to show my love to this broken world so that people would be transformed through me. Now that I've gone back to the Father in heaven, I left my spirit here. And so those who've received my love and been transformed by my spirit, and my spirit lives in their heart, now I want to love the world through the people who received my love, so that the world, the broken world, will see me living in people whose my spirit lives in, and they might receive my love and be transformed by me as well. So that's what this is about. Once you and I have received Christ's love, we become his agents or witnesses to a broken world, so that we are his hands and feet, he's our head, he flows through us to those around us so that they could meet him, find him, receive his love, and be transformed by him as well. Now, I've called this series Not of This World because the reality is, even though we live in this world, we're not to be of this world. We're not to live like the rest of the world, those who are broken. We're to live like those who've been saved by Christ. We're to live like those who Jesus wants to produce good things in and through. And really, that's going to be a lot of the focus of the message today as we talk about a tree and its fruit. Now, last week, our worship pastor, Harold, gave a message about the narrow gate and the wide gate, which were the verses just before the verses we're going to look at today. And the challenge he gave us was to share Christ with someone this week, and also to pray and then vote for godly people. So, how many of you last week either shared Christ with someone in some way or prayed for God to show you who to vote for and voted? Anyone do that? Awesome. I want to encourage you to take these assignments and put them to practice because that's where God's going to begin to change your life. Now, today we're talking about a tree and its fruit. And you know what? As I got to thinking about my personal life, I've recognized there have been a number of times that I will come home from work. And when I come home, sometimes I have a grumpy attitude. Now, I'm curious how many of you have ever come home from work with a grumpy attitude? Am I the only one who's ever done this? Hello, welcome to planet Earth. You're human, aren't you? And sometimes we do that, don't we? Now, let me tell you what I used to believe about my grumpy attitude. I used to believe that the reason that I had a grumpy attitude was because of all of the messed up people around me who just couldn't get things done right and I had to deal with their crud. That was my old philosophy. That's why my attitude was bad. I have since learned through the Word of God that other people aren't the cause of my grumpiness. But that my grumpiness on the outside is simply a reflection of crud inside my heart. And I began to confess that as sin to God and take ownership for my own personal wrongdoing instead of blaming the world for all my junk. Now, I'm curious. Have any of you ever made the mistake I've made, which is blaming the world for your junk instead of owning up to your own crud inside of yourself that gives you a bad attitude? All right. This is life-changing. I'm just going to tell you, it'll transform your life. When you quit blaming the world and everyone else for all the crud you got to deal with, and you start, because see, here's what Jesus said. He said, in this world, you're going to have troubles. I have found that to be a true statement. Anyone else find that to be true? It's a true statement. And he said, but take heart, because I have overcome the world. So check this out. What he's saying is, if we will allow Christ to have His way in our lives, He will give us an overcoming attitude that even though we live in this world that's full of crud and a lot of other people, Jesus' attitude and His perspective and His fruit will begin to be produced through us. And so even if everyone else around us is a jerk, we don't have to be. And we don't have to let it get us down. We don't have to let it destroy our day. We don't have to let it destroy our attitude. We don't have to be a jerk around our family because of all the pressure. We don't have to be that way if we let Jesus have His way in us. Well, really, that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about the fruit that is produced in our life and the heart that it reveals inside. Okay? If you're taking notes, one point for the message today. You can fill in the blanks. Here it is. You know a person's inner heart by examining their outer fruit, their attitudes and actions. And this isn't my idea. It's not something I came up with. This is Jesus' idea, okay? And so I want to show you where He teaches us this. As we step back into our passage, we're in Matthew chapter 7. That our outer fruit and actions and attitudes will reveal our inner heart. Matthew chapter 7, we're going to verse 15. If you have a Bible, open it there. If you don't, we have free Bibles. I don't think we have any at the front tables anymore. We have some at the back, but we're going to restock those this week and get those back up front here too. But feel free to go grab a free Bible, make it yours, write your name on it. This is God's love letter. It's His Word to you. It's the key to life. We're to feed off of God's Word. Matter of fact, I was just reading that the other day. I've been going through the Bible chronologically, so it's a little different than the book order on some of the books. But I just recently noticed in the desert when the Israelites were had just come out of Egypt and they're in the desert, God gives them food that is called manna, little cakes that would be produced with the dew on the surface. And God said, there's a reason that I gave you manna. They complained. They're like, hey, we're eating the same thing all the time. I mean, like, when I was in college, all I ate was ramen noodles, and I got a little tired of ramen noodles, okay? Well, here's the deal. They got sick and tired of always the same thing, and they're whining and complaining to God. And God tells us later, through Moses, the reason I gave you manna in the desert was to humble you and to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, on physical food, but man lives on every word that comes from the mouth of God. That the very thing that sustains our life and our being is God's Word, not just physical food. And if all you do is come on a Sunday morning and that's your only time in the Word is when I'm teaching or one of our pastors is teaching, then you are starving through the week. You have to learn to open the Word of God and to feed off of it on your own daily. And if you're new in your walk with the Lord, you may say, well, I've read parts of the Bible, I just don't get it. Trust me, I read parts of the Bible and I don't get it. But here's a little secret that I've learned. The secret is this. Before you read, here's what I pray. Lord, teach me. Teach me today. Because one of the jobs of the Holy Spirit that lives in us who are followers of Christ is to teach us to understand everything that Jesus taught us in the Word. So check it out. Let's rely on Jesus' Spirit that He left us to help us learn, help us grow, okay? And don't just chuck it out the window because you don't understand everything that you read, okay? Trust me, I've been reading this thing for years. I still don't understand everything in it. But I'm learning something every day I read. I'm learning something. God's teaching me something. So I want to encourage you to do that. Get into His Word. Now, we're in Matthew chapter 7, verse 15. The context here, last week, our worship pastor Harold talked about the wide gate and the narrow gate, the wide path that leads to destruction and death, and most people walk that destructive path that really the devil leads us down. But there's a narrow path, a narrow road that leads to true life. And this is the road that Jesus leads us down. And so our goal is to follow Jesus down the narrow path instead of following the devil down the broad path. In that context, Jesus makes then this statement in Matthew 7, verse 15. Watch out for what kind of folks? False prophets. Okay, these are the folks trying to lead you down the broad path that leads to destruction. Okay, now notice what he says. He says, they come to you in what kind of clothing? Sheep's clothing. They look all good and they seem all nice on the outside, but inwardly, inside they are what? Ferocious wolves. By their fruit, you will recognize them. Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree bears what kind of fruit? Good fruit. But a bad tree bears what kind of fruit? Bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear what kind of fruit? Bad fruit. And a bad tree cannot bear what kind of fruit? Good fruit. Every tree that does not bear what kind of fruit? Good fruit is cut down and thrown where? Into the fire. Thus, by their fruit, you will recognize them. And that's not their fruit of the looms, by the way. And so, Jesus teaches us this principle that we will know those who are truly following God by the fruit, their actions and attitudes of their life. He also teaches us that we will know the fruit of those we're letting influence our life. We will know whether they're leading us down the right path or the wrong path by their fruit, their attitudes and actions. So, let's break it down. First of all, Jesus tells us that we are to watch out for the false prophets, and by their fruit you will recognize them. This week, I picked this from the top of a tree in my backyard. Now, you are a smart bunch of folks here, so I want you to guess what tree is in my backyard. A peach tree. Oh, goodness. Orange tree. Come on. You guys are killing me here. It's an apple tree! Those of you who've seen an apple before know that this came from an apple tree. But how do you know that? Because you didn't go to my house and see the tree in the backyard. So how do you know that that tree is an apple tree? By the fruit. The fruit will tell you exactly what kind of tree that is. Now, Jesus is talking about people. And so when we are producing good fruit, fruit that looks like Jesus himself, people say that person has Christ living in them because their fruit is there, the fruit of Jesus showing through their life. However, Jesus says that trees that do not produce good fruit, he does something to. When we look at verse 19, every tree that does not bear good fruit is what? Cut down and thrown into the fire. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and oh yeah, it's fixing to get fun, trust me. And thrown into the fire. Oh yeah, we're burning stuff in church. Now, that produced a lot more smoke than first hour. If the smoke alarms go out, exits are to your left, your right, and... Okay. And thrown in the fire. You ever seen a burned leaf? Just kind of falls apart. Jesus said, when we're dried up like this, and we're not producing good fruit, it means we're not connected to Jesus, and it means we're destined ultimately for hell, where we will be burned up, but never die. We're just in pain and suffering forever and ever. Eternity is crazy. It's hard to fathom in our mind. It means never ends. Constant flame and fire. Well, that's what Satan wants for you and me. He wants our lives to be dried up like this and set on fire by the enemy and ruined. Jesus wants our lives to look like this. The choice is yours and mine. Interestingly enough, Scripture says that false prophets will encourage us down that broad path that leads to destruction and will encourage us to produce this instead of this. And in their own lives, they're producing this instead of this. If you're taking notes, write this down. False prophet. The word prophet, okay, actually means one who speaks God's message, mind, or word. The root there is prophecy or prophet or prophesy, also come from the same word prophet. Okay? So, a prophet is one who speaks God's word, speaks God's mind, or speaks God's message. In one sense, any time that you or I take God's word and speak it to someone, we are prophesying in one sense, in the very basic sense of the word. Now, in the Old Testament, we see sometimes that when they prophesied, God would sometimes share with some of the prophets in the Old Testament a message about something that has not yet happened. That's often spoken of as prophecy or to prophesy. But it doesn't always have to be a future event or a future thing that happens. Now, God says, watch out for false prophets. In other words, those who are going to lead you down the broad path that leads to destruction instead of the narrow path that leads to real life and good fruit. Okay? Now, how are you going to know a false prophet? By their fruit. So let me give you an example. There's a video out. There's a guy named Mario Joseph who Colin, my brother in Christ, shared with me a while back. And this guy was... born in India and raised in India. While he was in his mother's womb, the doctor said he was going to die. So his parents prayed. They were Muslim. His parents prayed to Allah that the child would be spared. Well, not by any act of Allah, by the grace of the one true living God, he was spared and he came to life. Here's what's interesting, though. His parents committed him to be raised up in the Muslim in a Muslim mosque school, and for 10 years he went through this training to become a Muslim imam, which is a parish priest of a Muslim mosque. At 19 years old, he became a priest of a Muslim mosque in India. So Mario Joseph was taught in his school and taught to his church. And one Sunday he said, I was preaching. And while I was preaching, I was preaching specifically that day that Jesus is not God, which is what Muslims believe. And he said, someone in my congregation stood up and said, well, who is Jesus? Who is he? And he said, the question haunted me. And he said, I started thinking, well, who is Jesus? You know, I was taught and I've always believed he is not God. So if he's not God, well, then who is he? Which is a really good question. A question everyone needs to ask. Now, he was raised that the Quran was the holiest of books. And so he went to the Quran and read through it again and was wanting to know what the Quran said about Jesus and what the Quran said about Muhammad and was wanting to compare the two. Because Islam or Muslims follow Muhammad. They call him the last great prophet, greater than Jesus, and anything that Muhammad said was right, true, and the way, and they followed him ever since. Thus became the Muslim faith. What's interesting is, as he read through the Quran, he recognized that he recognized that Jesus was mentioned more times in the Quran than Muhammad, which struck him when he counted the number of times out. Then he noticed that the Quran says that Jesus actually formed a bird from a lump of clay and breathed that bird's life into existence, which I found very interesting. I didn't know that the Quran said that. He said it also says that Jesus healed sick people, says that he raised a man from the dead, that the Quran says this, and that Jesus himself rose from the grave, and that Jesus himself is supposed to come back to this world someday. And he said, I got to thinking about this, and he's like, wait a minute, Muhammad isn't mentioned as much in the Quran. And Muhammad never created anything and breathed life into existence. And he said, then I got to thinking, Muhammad never healed any sick people. And then I got to thinking, Muhammad is still in his grave and still dead. He never rose from the dead. And then I got to thinking, Muhammad's not supposed to come back in any form. So why the heck am I following Muhammad? Who's supposed to be the greatest prophet? The rest of the story, in simple, is this. Mario Joseph gave his life to Christ. And he travels and speaks about Christ. He's in the Catholic Church, which is a little interesting. but he's got Jesus right. We agree on Jesus. As God in flesh, Savior of the world. And I want us to, for example's sake, to compare two prophets. Who both called themselves prophets, Muhammad and Jesus. When you look at the fruit of Muhammad's life, you'll find that he hated anyone who did not believe what he believed, so much so he had them killed. You'll find that Muhammad had several wives and even took on a young girl at age 6 and had relations with her and ultimately married her. When you judge that prophet, so-called self-proclaimed prophet, by his fruit, what do you see? You see fruit that's going to burn up. You see a branch that's cut off. However, when you judge Jesus by his fruit, what was Jesus all about? Love. He summed up the entire Bible from cover to cover, really, in one word. That word, he said, love. And then he said, apply it in two ways. First of all, you love your God who created you. Second of all, you love everyone else around you. Muhammad fruit, hate. Jesus fruit, love. See a difference? But there's more. Not only did Jesus love everyone, Jesus made the whole purpose of his life to let his love transform broken people who'd screwed up. He even wanted to transform Muhammad. Muhammad didn't believe Jesus was God in the flesh. So he didn't get to get transformed, because he chose not to be. Jesus said, even love your enemies. He said, pray for those who persecute you, because I've called you to love. The main fruit of Jesus is love. So when I judge two prophets by their fruit, self-proclaimed prophets, which prophet am I going to follow? Not the false prophet, Muhammad, the one true God in flesh, Jesus. Now, you need to know this, friends. There are tons of false prophets. And if you follow a false prophet, he's going to lead you. You're going to become what he becomes. He's going to lead you down the path to destruction. Okay? People you hang around with will rub off on you. So we need to be looking pretty carefully at what kind of fruit are the people we're listening to producing in their life. And we need to be examining our own fruit and say, what are we producing in our lives? So the question becomes, what outer fruit am I looking for in my life and others? Okay? Now, this first verse is John 15:5. Okay? Jesus said, I am the vine and you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will do what? You will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. All right, now this isn't a perfect example, because if it was, I'm going to say this is Jesus, this is the vine, but you need to picture this as green and full of life, okay? This is us, this is the branch. When we are connected closely to Jesus, the vine, he will produce his life up and through us so that our branch produces, ka-ching! See how that works? That's how it works. If we are closely connected to Jesus, his life brings fruit, spiritual fruit, just like Jesus' own fruit in our life. However, if we are not closely connected to Jesus and we're cut off, then guess what we're producing? None of this, just getting burned up by the flames. The secret is staying closely connected to the vine, Jesus. Now, if we stay closely connected to the vine, Jesus, what kinds of fruit will be produced? I'm so glad you ask. Let's look at that now. We are going to be in Galatians 5, verse 16, and then we're going to be in 1 Corinthians 13. I shared these passages a few weeks ago, but we need to revisit them, especially when we're talking about what kind of fruit's being produced in our life. So the first one we look at is Galatians 5, 16 through 25. The Bible tells us, so I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh, for the flesh desires what is contrary or opposite to the Spirit. And the Spirit, what is contrary or opposite to the flesh? So they are in what? They're in a conflict. They're in a battle with each other, so that you do not do whatever you want. You don't just do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. So this is how it works. When you choose to follow Christ, the Spirit of God comes, lives in your heart. He wants to lead your life. He wants you to keep in step and to follow his lead. When we're doing that, we're closely connected to the vine, and so our branch is producing good fruit when we're letting the Spirit lead us. When we, however, are letting our flesh, which is our sinful nature, it's our desire to do what we want, when we want, how we want. It's all about us. When our flesh leads, we're not producing any fruit at all. Well, we're producing rotten fruit is what we're doing. We're not producing good fruit. Okay? And so, notice this. What are the fruit of the flesh? What is the burned up fruit of the flesh that's rotten? Well, here it is, verse 19. When we're not connected to Jesus, and we're not staying constantly in connection with him, the acts of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, which means sex with someone you're not married to. Husband, wife, male, female, as God created them in Genesis chapter 1 and 2. Marriage, sex. Anything outside of that is flesh. It's going to be burned up. It's not going to last. It's going to lead us down the path to destruction. Impurity and debauchery, flesh. Idolatry, which is worshiping and living for created things rather than the Creator, whether it's your phone, your car, your house, your spouse, your children. Idolatry, work of the flesh, it'll be burned up. If Jesus isn't first and foremost in everything. Notice this, anything we put before God is an idol. Witchcraft, hatred. You ever hated anyone? That's this. It's bad fruit. Discord, okay, which is trying to cause fights and division. Bad fruit. Jealousy, wishing you had what everyone else had, what your neighbor has. Guys wishing you had his job or his vehicle. Girls wishing you had her body or whatever. It's all flesh. Okay? It's all going to be burned up. Fits of rage, coming unglued and letting your anger get the best of you, throwing fits. It's all fruit of the flesh. It's bad fruit. Selfish ambition about what you want, when you want, how you want, and not caring what happens to other people as a result. Flesh. Dissensions, factions, causing division. All fruit of the flesh. Bad fruit. Envy. Always wanting what everyone else has. Bad fruit. Drunkenness. Drugs. Bad fruit. Orgies. I'll let you figure that out on your own, but it's bad fruit. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit what? The kingdom of God. Now, quick question. If all of this is bad fruit, and because you're a human being like me, I have sometimes produced some bad fruit and so have you, is there any hope for us? Yes, but only in who? Jesus the vine. The more closely we are connected to Jesus, the more good fruit we'll produce and the less bad fruit. Now remember what we said from the beginning? Our fruit reveals to us the inner heart. Let me tell you a couple things about the heart. The heart can be hard and not let God do His work. Or the heart can be soft and let the Holy Spirit, Jesus, do His work in and through us. What I've learned is, and this is good news, your heart condition can change. If you're a person who's had a hard heart towards God, your heart can soften. And you can choose to receive and let God transform your life. If you have a soft heart, here's the flip side. Here's the scary piece. You can have a soft heart towards God, and then one day you can harden your heart towards God. You can even do that for a year after you've had a soft heart towards God for years. But check this out. Your heart condition can change in 1 second. Did you know that? You could go from, man, I'm letting Jesus lead me. He's producing good fruit, to hardening my heart, and instead of letting the Holy Spirit lead, my flesh is leading in that moment, and I spout off in anger, or I steal something, or I lie to someone to make myself look better. In an instant, a follower of Christ can choose to deny the Spirit, or quench the Spirit, the Scripture tells us, and produce a fleshly, ugly fruit. Now, does that person go to heaven or hell? There's a deep theological question. I'm going to give you a real simple answer to. You only go to heaven one way. Any idea? Through Jesus and what He did, His perfection on the cross. Not your perfection. However, if you say you're a follower of Christ and you're not producing any of this, you're not following Jesus at all. If all you're producing is this, you're not really a follower of Christ, because Christ is life, and his vine always, always produces good fruit in the branches that are connected to him. Not that they don't ever produce some bad fruit, but he will always produce some good fruit because we're connected to him. Make sense? If your life is characterized, though, by bad fruit, and we're not seeing this good fruit, and we're not seeing more of it as time goes, then you're probably not walking with Jesus. You're probably walking with yourself. Now, what we're fixing to look at now is what kind of fruit is produced when we're staying close to Jesus. And someone's going to have fun cleaning all this mess up here. So let's look at the fruit that should be produced if we're following and staying closely connected to Jesus. Here we go. It's in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. The fruit of the Spirit, if we're closely connected to Christ, is what? You say it with me. This is the good fruit. It is love, joy, peace, forbearance or patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires, so we live by the Spirit. Let us keep what? In step with the Spirit. Jesus leading us so that he produces the fruit, the good fruit, through our branch. Now, I want you to notice this. The good fruit will always come when we're connected to Jesus, when we're closely connected. But when we choose to live on what we want instead of what he wants, that's when we'll produce some nastiness. I told you that Jesus, the greatest thing that he represented in the Bible, he summed up the whole Bible: love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind, love your neighbor as yourself, in love. So one of the fruit here that's listed, love, joy, peace, one of them is love. And love is so big. It encompasses so many things. We need to talk about it for just a moment. Love in and of itself, by itself, produces these things, okay? This kind of fruit through us. Say it with me in 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast everyone. It is not proud. It is not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. That's the kind of fruit that Jesus wants to produce through you and through me. Here's our assignment this week. Here's what I want us to do. Three things. Number one, examine your own life fruit. Examine your attitudes and actions by praying through Galatians 5, 16 through 25, and 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8, the verses we just went through. Then write down what God shows you about your own heart, because your fruit reveals your heart. If need be, repent and make a U-turn and asking God's forgiveness and his help by his Spirit that lives in you to change. Do that. Examine your fruit. Because if you're a person who's producing this more and more and more over your life, you're in trouble. And I seriously doubt that you're connected to the vine. Now, a good way to know if you're growing, you say, how do I know if I'm growing in the Lord or if I'm dying? Ask someone who knows you, maybe even someone who lives with you. Look at my life today, examine the fruit of my life today, and examine my fruit a year ago. Am I producing more of this today than I was a year ago? Or am I producing more of this today than I was a year ago? Ask someone who knows you well, a follower of Christ, to be honest with you. And you'll know whether or not you're growing. Other people see it. We can't hide it. When I come home grumpy, as much as I'd like to hide it from my wife and my kids, when I'm grumpy, it's an external fruit that's being produced. Okay? Other people see it. But this is the fruit that Jesus wants to produce through us. So examine your own life fruit. Repent. Get right with God. Ask Him to help you produce good fruit. Number two, examine the fruit of the people you listen to and follow, as you will become like them. The Bible says that bad company corrupts good character. The people you choose to let influence your life the most, you will become like them. So watch out. You better cautiously look at and examine the fruit in the person's life that you are letting influence you. And then ask God to show you what people you should give less influence to in your life, because they're leading you down a broad path to destruction. And ask Him what people you should give more influence to in your life, because they're going to lead you down the narrow path that Jesus is walking. Now, those people can't produce the fruit in your life. The source of the fruit is always the vine, Jesus. But when you're following them, the Apostle Paul said, "Follow me as I follow Christ." They're encouraging you to stay more closely connected to the vine Jesus so that you'll produce good fruit. You with me? That's how it's supposed to work. The third thing I want to encourage you to do is to speak and live out God's word faithfully. All right? The most general sense of the word prophet or prophesy or prophecy is to speak God's word. Be a person that speaks God's word to other people. But not just someone who says it, but someone whose fruit in your life shows it. Okay? Be a person who stands up for the things of God and lets Him produce His goodness in you. And that way you're able to share His love, speak His truth, His words into others. And then when His good love comes to them, they're like, "Oh, that looks delicious. Well, Jesus is. He's amazing. Take a bite." You know, the Bible actually says, "Taste and see that the Lord is good." Take a bite of Jesus. Just receive a little bit of His love and watch Him transform your whole life. That's what He'll do. You know what our job is? Our job is to stay connected to the vine, so that Jesus will produce good fruit. The primary fruit that Jesus produces is love. Then we share it with others so that they can taste and see that the Lord is good, and so that Jesus can come into their lives and transform them, so that they get connected and grafted into the same good vine of Jesus, so that they produce good fruit. The main fruit is love, and they share His love with others so that they can taste and see that the Lord is good, so that they can be transformed by Jesus and grafted into the vine of Jesus, so that He can produce through them good. Are you getting the picture? That's how it works. I want to be a part of a church, not of perfect people, but of genuine people who truly stay closely connected to Jesus. And when we mess up, we fess up. And we ask for His power to change us and to produce more and more of this, so that we can share it with broken people, so He can transform them. You know what God will do through a church full of people with that heart? He'll transform this world one broken life at a time. I want to be a part of a church like that. Anybody with me? All of us together for Jesus, whatever it takes. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we are so thankful that You are the one true God. Jesus, we are so thankful that You are the true prophet. Jesus, we're so thankful that you revealed to us the Father. You revealed God to us. You showed us the way, the truth, the life through you. Thank you, Jesus, for your fruit. Thank you that you're all about loving, not about hating. Thank you that your fruit shows us that you're the real deal. Thank you, Jesus, that we can, as messed up as we are, we can simply choose to receive, to ask forgiveness and admit we're wrong and ask you to change us, and that you will actually graft us into you, Jesus, and that we'll get connected with you and that you'll produce good fruit through us, fruit that we can't even produce on our own. Jesus, thank you that this was your master plan and that we get to participate. And Jesus, show us our fruit this week. Help us be honest. Show us how to stay closely connected to you in your word, feeding off of every word that comes from your mouth and allowing you to transform and change us and to produce this amazing fruit of your love. Show us how to pass this fruit on to others, your love, and that they might have a chance to taste and see your good, and that you want to, Lord, would you transform the lives of not only us, but the people around us through this process. Lord, would you give us discernment to be cautious of the people that we allow influence into our life. Show us who we need to give less influence to. Show us who we need to give more influence to in our life. And Jesus, ultimately, may you have the most influence in our life. And Lord, help us to speak your word and to show it through our actions and attitudes. In the precious, holy name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Friends, we're going to put a prayer up on the screen. And as you're reading through that, maybe you're here today and maybe you have never truly given your heart to Christ. Maybe you're a person who has tried some other religions. Maybe you've kind of thought religion is hogwash and you just kind of lived your life for yourself, but you haven't really connected with the Creator, Jesus. And maybe today you're realizing, maybe for the first time ever, that Jesus truly is the good fruit. That there has never been anyone who's ever lived who's produced more good fruit than Jesus. Friend, did you know that even in secular, non-Christian writings, no one has ever been able to prove Jesus guilty of any sin ever, not even one. The only thing he was ever accused of was blasphemy, claiming to be God on earth. And that's why they crucified him. There is no one who's ever lived who's produced the fruit that he has. And Jesus is offering to you his love, his choice fruit, that it would change and transform your life. You just have to open up your heart. You just have to soften your heart and quit being hard and closed mind to your Creator. Open your heart. Jesus wants to plant the seed of his life and fruit in your heart right now, and he wants to start a brand new life. And there's something in you that's drawing you to him, and it's the fact that when he created you, he pressed his thumb into your heart and left an indention that only Christ can fit. And he's saying to you today, come home. Come home to your Creator and let me transform your broken life because I love you. Friends, if your prayer would be for the very first time ever, Jesus, I'm wrong, I'm a sinner, you're right, forgive me. I turn away from my sin, I turn to you. Come into my life through your Holy Spirit that you left here when you died on the cross, were buried and rose again. Come live in me. Lead me through life. And when I die, lead me into heaven with you. That's his promise. His Spirit is the seal that guarantees eternal life in heaven. Because Jesus alone was able to be perfect God and perfect human, sacrifice on the cross to be your substitute. He took your place. The punishment you deserve and hell and the fire and the flames that you deserve, that I deserve, Jesus took your punishment. He said, I'm going to take your place, and if you'll just accept what I did and follow me with your life, I'll forgive you of every sin. I'll lead you through life. I'll produce this in your life, and I'll take you to heaven with me where there's no more suffering, crying, heartache, or tears. That's what Jesus is offering to you today. And some of you, you're sitting here and there's a tug on your heart. There's a lump in your throat, and it's because the Holy Spirit of God is reaching out to you and He's drawing you to Him right now. And He's asking you to say yes. Friend, if this would be your prayer, maybe for the first time ever, to open your heart to Christ and let Him plant His seed in your life. Or maybe for you, it's a serious recommitment. You recognize that for too much of your life, you've been producing this instead of this, and it's time to reconnect, recommit to Jesus, the living vine. If that would be your prayer today, for the first time or a serious recommitment, would you be bold right now and just raise your hand and say, "That's me. This is my heart." Praise God. Praise God, friends. Man, praise God for you. Praise God. Listen, friends, if you just raised your hand, or even if you didn't raise your hand, but in your heart, you want to commit solidly to Christ today, or recommit solidly to Him today, would you meet me to the left of the red cross right now? I'll turn a light on there in a moment and a door there. And I would love to pray with you and encourage you as you take this step and connect to Jesus. All right, so respond as God puts in your heart now.